So I'd like to kind of delve into these different thinkers, of the modern age of anarchism, and I'd love to get your thoughts on the contributions that they made. And the first person I want to discuss is Noam Chomsky, somebody who's been on this show several times now, and just a giant figure in the world of not just libertarian thought, but also linguistics.
Well, just in terms of his ideology, I haven't followed it very closely in recent years. I would say, just generally speaking, I'm, somewhat softer or less hostile toward his reformist tendencies and his views on social democracy than I used to be. I mean, I've always said that, social democracy and neoliberal capitalism of the Reagan and Thatcher variety are equally statist, and if I had to choose between one or the other, I wouldn't hesitate to choose living under social democracy, because I prefer the form of statism whose boot weighs less oppressively on my neck. But just generally speaking, I'm more open to the idea of what Andre Gortz called non-reformist reforms, and on the idea of reform as something you can go through on the path towards systemic change rather than necessarily around, so long as you don't give away all your cards to it, or put all your eggs in that basket or whatever, and you retain the agency to operate outside of it, and pursue multiple simultaneous paths. I still don't see things like social democracy or the Bernie-crats or Corbynism or whatever as a primary path for achieving a post-state, post-capitalist society, but I see them as things that could at least create a relatively libertarian and benign background environment for the stuff that really is important, like building the counter institutions on the ground, building the structure of the new society in the shell of the old, as the old cliche goes. But for me, Chomsky's main influence was not ideological in terms of any kind of coherent vision of the future, so much as it was of my understanding of the past. He probably did more for me than any other thinker in introducing me to just the horrible history of coercion involved in American and European imperialism and the whole violent history behind the origin of capitalism, to the other most influential figures for me, Gabriel Kolko, with his work on the final stages of World War II and the crafting of the post-war economic order, and William Blum's book, Blum, his book, Killing Hope, on the history of U.S. covert interventions around the world since World War II, are both things that Chomsky's footnotes actually introduced me to. I think I read Chomsky's book, Deterring Democracy, was the first book of his I read in 1999, and that led me to reading a lot of his other major books on foreign policy and the history of imperialism, and playing footnote hockey, pursuing a lot of his recommendations like Kolko and Blum, and just really radicalized my understanding of foreign affairs.
Chomsky's an interesting figure for many different reasons, but one reason that I guess struggle with, what he says and what he writes sometimes is that he's extremely pragmatic to the point of maybe sometimes I can't really follow if he's advocating for something that is an ideal solution or if something that, we should just sort of compromise on. I know that during the 2016 election, he was saying that people in swing states should vote for Hillary Clinton.
I like Jill Stein's policies, but in the real world, that's not an option now. I mean, I'd probably vote for her in Massachusetts, as I have before, but that's because Massachusetts is not a swing state.
Right.
If I were in a swing state, say Ohio, I would want to keep, I would vote for any Democrat for a very simple reason.
Even Hillary Clinton, you'd vote for Hillary
Clinton? Including Hillary Clinton for a very good reason. Refusal to vote for Hillary Clinton in a swing state is a vote for the Republicans. You can pretend otherwise if you like, but that's what it amounts
to. Well, I'm just curious because she seems so close to Republicans and
no,
so many.
She's not. There's plenty of difference. She's not saying let's carpet bomb Syria, for example. She's not saying let's tear up the Iranian nuclear deal. She's not saying let's destroy the world because we oppose any move on the climate. Mm. These are non-trivial distinctions. Non-trivial. A lot depends on them. And to say I'm going to vote for a Republican because there's no difference is, in my view, pretty crazy. And a refusal to vote for whoever the Democrat is in effect a vote for whatever Republican candidate comes out, Cruz, Trump, whoever it turns out to be. Mm. You can't avoid the world. You can like to pretend the world isn't there, but it is there.
He also repeatedly says, you know, in the real world, we should do this, in the real world, we should do that. But there's also instances where he seems to be saying that we should, even in an ideal society, be advocating for some sort of seemingly non-libertarian solutions. And actually something that I brought up to him about you was gun control. I know that you've written against gun control and you talked about how the Black Panthers had used firearms to kind of protect themselves when they were building their movement. And Noam Chomsky seemed to push back on that.
First of all, that's utter, total illusion. Has no relation to the actual world. Now, let's take the Black Panther case. I suppose you had given assault rifles to the Black Panthers. Would that have helped them? No. The state would have come in with tanks. Give them anti-tank weapons. The state will come in with B-52s. I mean, the balance of power is overwhelmingly in the force of the state. The idea that any armed resistance to the state is conceivable is kind of like having a debate about the best ice cream cones on Mars. We're not even talking about the real world.
So I don't know if maybe you have any sort of response on at least that issue.
Let me step back first, you know, to the broader point of what we're doing in the real world practically versus the ultimate goal. I suppose I've gradually shifted to being one of those people who would say, just for purely strategic reasons, push for, you know, ranked choice voting, promote radicals in the party primaries, as far left as you want to go, but in the end, hold your nose and vote for whoever on the ballot is most likely to get Trump and the fascists out in the short run, because I would see even the most contemptible centrist DNC mediocrity on the ballot as being at least a way of giving off the worst of the immediate fascist onslaught and buying time for a lot of other things like demographic shift, leftward demographic shift towards left-leaning millennials, towards institution buildings, towards the United States becoming less wide and right-wing over time, so we can buy the breathing space we need for actually building the kind of positive society we want. So I don't necessarily see the practical assessments like that as being in any way at odds with ultimate or ideal goals. I just see them as a means that with a very limited purpose, because I see the alternatives as very dubious or implausible. The accelerationist proposals for making things worse before they get better, or pushing the system towards the breaking point, because I ultimately don't see what faster left-wing shift we're going to get or faster progress we're going to get in the long run by throwing the election in the short run and allowing fascists to seize power, you know, for several years or a decade or whatever before we reach the tipping point. I think it would be much easier to negotiate the transition even under someone really horrible like Clinton than I see any plausible accelerationist or revolutionary scenario And as far as, the social democratic stuff, again, I see that as more of, even electing someone like Bernie Sanders or Jeremy Corbyn as probably the best case realistic scenario, in which case it would create much more benign background conditions for the kinds of transformations we want to create outside the state. But either way, I think anyone who has any major hopes for achieving it primarily through the state, through the kinds of policies that eventually democratic socialist or Bernie-crat types would push through, I think they attach a lot more significance to electoral politics than I do. I'm just looking for the most benign background condition we can have for doing the important stuff. Getting back to the specific question of gun control, to be honest, if you want to look it up, I did a review of the book Scott Crow edited, Setting Sights, on the history of left-wing thought on gun ownership. But my basic position is, that arguments for gun ownership by ordinary people as a way of resisting state and class oppression resonate very strongly with me, but the loudest voices in American anti-gun control culture, on the other hand, I feel very alienated from. And to be honest, I don't really feel emotionally that strongly about the issue of gun control one way or the other, because I don't think it's going to make a big difference what the law is. I think in the United States, the effects of enforcing such laws are going to be relatively limited one way or the other. Whatever benefits come to ownership of weapons by armed workers, by people of color, by LGBT groups and other marginalized people probably aren't going to be affected that much by gun law. And as far as gun violence goes, I think that has more to do with American culture. A lot of stuff going back to settler culture, the Second Great Awakening, American exceptionalism, and that sort of thing, than it does with what the specific gun laws are. So it's something, I have a lot of theoretical views on, but it's not a hot-button practical issue for me one way or the other.